Welcome to the Platts Commodity Pulse. My name is Andrew Bonington, Editorial Director for Oil Strategic Market Engagement. I'm joined by my colleagues, Eklavya Gupta, Senior Editor for European and African Oil News, and Ahila Karan, European and African Oil Markets Editor, to discuss the state of play for the African refining industry amid what is really the ongoing quest for low sulphur fuels. This is ahead of the African Refiners Association annual general meeting in Cape Town on March the 12th to the 14th, where we will all be present. Really, to give a bit of background to this, last year the theme of the conference was very much one of low sulphur fuels and how Africa can really make that jump to European specification low sulphur fuels. Some of the issues around Africa: a very big crude oil producer, obviously around 9 million barrels a day of crude oil production, but only 3.5 million barrels a day of refining capacity. So really a real need to increase capacity to improve the logistics and improve the refined product balance of the continent. As I said, very much the theme last year was low sulfur fuels and how Africa can make that step to lower sulfur fuels. Ahila, really for you to start with, what are some of the developments in the last year in Africa in its mission to move to low sulfur fuels?
Yeah, so there's been quite a few changes actually. So if we look back maybe January 2017, we saw sort of Tunisia moving to a lower sulfur cap as well, kind of getting in line with all its other North African markets as well for gas oil. So this is gas oil used for road fuel and also power generation. They moved down to 1,000 ppm, having been at 2,000 ppm. Then we also saw in East Africa, sort of Kenya and Tanzania for the last 2 years have been a low sulfur gas oil markets. And we saw Mozambique, Zimbabwe, Malawi all move to 50 ppm, this low sulfur gas oil market early this year. But the real story, I mean, is Ghana in West Africa, right? Moving to the 50 ppm sulfur cap.
Yeah, so what's been happening in Ghana specifically? As you said, like a big story there, yeah. Big growing population. What are some of the changes there in the last year?
Yeah, so with Ghana, I mean, 2 years ago, we were talking about Nigeria, Togo, Benin, Ivory Coast, Ghana, all moving to a lower sulfur cap. But last year, it was actually Ghana that moved. They're the only low sulfur gas oil market in West Africa now. They moved from 3,000 ppm sulfur to 50 ppm, so quite a drastic change in August last year. So the way it all worked is they had a 3 month waiver period domestically. Mm-hmm. So anyone that had product domestically that was off spec, that was the high sulfur material, they had 3 months to sort of get rid of it. Now things are moving on in terms of discussions about giving a waiver to their local refinery because this refinery hasn't yet been upgraded to produce the low sulfur requirements. So there'll be some sort of kind of fee paid for any sort of off-spec material that's sold into the market. But that's sort of how they're dealing with it until 2020. And then there are, you know, several refinery upgrades, and they even mention a new refinery at Takoradi as well that's 150,000 barrels a day. So quite a few changes on the Ghana side.
Okay, that's interesting. I mean, still in West Africa, Eklavya, I mean, we talked a lot about Ghana there, but, you know, in many ways, the big prize or the big country in terms of oil demand in West Africa is Nigeria. So what are some of the developments there in Nigeria that we've seen in the last year?
Yeah, sure. So Nigeria, as we know, is Africa's largest oil producer, but it is also Africa's largest, you know, importer of gasoline and gas oil. And it faces a sort of critical period, I would say, especially in the next sort of 3 to 5 years. Since December last year, we've had chronic gasoline shortages. And they've sort of experimented with different models to import some of that gasoline. It hasn't always sort of turned up at the right time. The one thing that NNPC, you know, has sort of hefty ambitions on is trying to end gasoline imports in the next 2 to 3 years. Now, this is actually, I would say, a lot of traders treat this with a lot of skepticism. Mm-hmm. One of the key things that they're trying to do is part of the refinery rehabilitation program. Now, we've heard reports that there's trading companies and oil majors that have, you know, working in a consortium, and they will help rehabilitate some of the refineries in Nigeria. Now, Nigeria, it's quite sad in a way is that it has around 445,000 barrels per day of refining capacity. These refineries have been really operating in less than about 20% in the last 6 months. So there's a lot of challenges there for Nigeria, but there's also a lot of opportunity. One thing to mention is that in the next, say, 3 to 4 years, maybe by 21, 2022, we might have a new big refinery in just outside Lagos. In fact, a 600,000 barrels per day refinery by Aliko Dangote, who is actually Africa's richest man. So there's a lot of hope on this refinery, and if it can deliver, it could actually have, you know, a dramatic sort of impact on the region and maybe even in Europe and US, because these are the two regions that Nigeria and West Africa depend a lot on for products.
Yeah, okay, interesting. I mean, we've talked about Ghana and Nigeria, obviously big crude oil producing countries, and you know, a lot of the other developments are also in crude oil producing countries when we come to a new refining capacity. Can you give us an overview of some of those other countries and how they're pushing the refining story as well?
Sure. So one very interesting thing as well is that in West Africa, which is basically a big importer of gasoline and gas oil, doesn't really have a functioning flued catalytic cracker, which is, you know, essential for making additional gasoline. Sonangol recently said that it is planning to build an FCC cracker at its Luanda refinery. Now it has, you know, it has ambitions to build a new refinery in Lobito in by 21-22. Now this was supposed to happen. The plans were shelved. As you know, with Angola, there's been sort of a change in precedent, and that has resulted in a change in Sonangol, which is the state-owned oil company. They're also sort of experimenting in ways how to import gasoline and gas oil in different ways. We also have Gabon, which has refinery upgrade works along with Cameroon, and there are plans also in sort of countries like Ivory Coast to sort of build new refineries. But so, you know, there is one school of thought that almost 1 million barrels per day of new refining capacity could come online in West Africa in the next sort of 3 to 5 years, okay, which could again be a game changer in that regard.
Yeah, okay, interesting. And I think, you know, from that, as much as anything, it's clear Africa is a very big continent, goes without saying, but also the different parts of the continent have very different dynamics when it comes to the oil industry. West Africa, really, where the crude oil production is very much focused, and East Africa is going very much a different direction than West Africa. East Africa, Kenya, Tanzania, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, that group of countries, the East African community, has a very big population, 170 million, but no working oil refinery since Mombasa closed in 2013. So unlike West Africa, East Africa has no refining and is completely reliant on imports. A very different system, and a very transparent system of imports as well, where the state regulators are responsible for importing products into Kenya, into Tanzania, and a lot of that material making its way inland to those other countries. So a very different system. So refining not necessarily the only answer that Africa is looking at improving its sulfur content of its products, or also just simply in terms of boosting its supply of products as well. Imports a different answer, if you like, to the story than the traditional refining story. But also, I mean, given that sulfur reductions are only in, you know, a few countries really across Africa, we as a company, have been looking at sort of localized or local regional assessments for Africa. We launched the gasoline assessment 3 years ago for West African grey gasoline and Dahila. I know that we're looking very closely at gas oil and a gas oil assessment for West Africa. Could you, you know, give us some ideas of some of the things we're looking at there?
Yeah, so it's kind of the Lomé market is where the kind of high sulfur gas oil trading hub is for West Africa. It's still a very big and relevant market. I know we've just talked about Ghana moving to a lower sulfur cap for its imports, but you know, when we speak to Ghanaian importers, they look at perhaps a different kind of way of pricing, and that's sort of unique to them. But for the rest of West Africa, they're sort of looking at the offshore Lomé market for sort of product. And for us, we see that the Nigerian 0.3% gas oil is the most widely traded product in the offshore market. And so this is why we're launching a new assessment offshore Lomé for the Nigerian 0.3% gas oil, and that's going to be launched in April of this year. So it's kind of an exciting opportunity. This is it's kind of the only dedicated West African gas gas oil assessment out there. I'm sure there are other freight net forwards, but this really does look at the supply and demand dynamics in that region for, you know, what is actually traded, 5,000 to 10,000 metric ton clip sizes.
So thank you very much, Clavier and Ahila, for your thoughts and views on the African market. And thank you very much for listening to this latest edition of Commodity Pulse. For those of you attending the African Refiners Conference in Cape Town in March, please do come and say hello, and we look forward to seeing you there.